You know, but once that nominee is chosen, it's time for us to be adults and get over it. And not stay home and sulk over the fact that our candidate didn't get elected or didn't get nominated and decide not to vote, that you're just going to show people that it's just not voting. That is exactly why we have what we have in the White House today. That you get over your differences, you get over your feelings being hurt. So today we have Art Gardner from the Pennington Senate, U.S. Senate. We have David Pennington and John Barge, both of whom are running for governor of Georgia. So without anything else said, we're going to go. Let's go 20 minutes each. And we're going to start with John because he has to be in Bartow at another event. Right there, okay? And then we're going to move to Art, and then move to David, and 20 minutes each, and let's go ahead and get started.
Good morning, and thank you for having us. This is a large crowd to be out this early in the morning. I appreciate y'all coming out. I am a Cobb County native, born and raised in Smyrna, graduated from Campbell High School in 1984. Just a little background information on me and who I am and my family. I graduated from Campbell. I went to college at Berry College in Rome, Georgia, on academic and journalism scholarships. I kind of fell in love with the rural life and stayed there, so I have been a resident of Floyd County for almost 30 years. I met my wife, Lorraine, there in church. We've been married for 23 years this year. We have an 18-year-old daughter who I guess unabashedly brag on. She will be valedictorian of her graduating class in a couple of weeks. And she also attended. I wish that they had time to be with me, but she is quite active in horseback riding, and she participates in Jordan High School Rodeo, and she is pretty much on the road every weekend somewhere in across Georgia or Alabama or Tennessee participating in rodeo events. So she has a very busy schedule. So after graduating from Berry, I went on to teach school. I'm a career educator. I taught high school English, I got my master's in special degrees in education leadership from the University of West Georgia, and my doctorate degree from the University of Georgia in education leadership. Because I felt like as a teacher, if I had the ability to help young people, if I could influence the minds of young people as a teacher for those 100 or so kids that I see every day, then as a principal, I could have that type of influence over the entire school. Because I could set the tone for my school, I could hire the correct teachers to interact with my students. And if that was the case, then as a superintendent, then I could have that kind of influence over the community by making sure I had the right principals who had the right vision and they set the right tone for their school districts. So I went on and became a principal, high school principal, and one day my phone rang and it was the State Department of Education. And I said, we have a job, yeah, here, we want to talk to you about. And I became the State Director of Career and Technical Education with the Department of Education. And I saw for the first time the policy-making side of education, and I saw people in positions, policy-making positions, who were making decisions that impacted our children and our teachers that didn't really have an understanding of how those decisions impacted them because they weren't educators, never had been, and they didn't listen to educators. So that's why I started thinking, you know, several years ago, that maybe I'll run for state school superintendent. So I did run for state superintendent in 2010, thank you very much. Was elected in 2010 as state superintendent, and I've served in that role since then. So, as serving as state school superintendent has been, it's been an incredibly rewarding experience. And again, what I began to see was people in policy-making positions, making decisions that impacted people across the state that didn't understand, that didn't see the impact. Because if you get outside of Metro Atlanta, Georgia, there's some real challenges in our state. There's some challenges in Metro, For me, it began looking at education and seeing the impact of budget cuts, what budget cuts have done to our school systems across the state. Just here in Cobb County in the last 4 years, the state has withheld over $175 million from the Cobb County School District that they've earned through the state funding formula. I understand austerity, I understand difficult budget times, but we have to understand that education is the single most important investment that we can make in our state's future. So, thinking about running for governor, there are more things than besides education to this state. There's economic development, there's jobs, there's poverty, there's ethics. All of these are issues in this particular race. So, you know, the impact on schools, I'll start with education, the impact on schools across the state of Georgia. Two-thirds of our school districts are no longer in school 180 days a year. That's the state minimum required by law. They cannot afford to keep the doors open and pay their teachers. We have a handful of districts, some close to where I live, whose calendars this year are 146 days. Y'all, that's nearly 2 months of instruction that children in those communities are not receiving. You want to talk about economic development? What kind of business or industry are you going to attract to a community where the students are in school 146 days? It's not going to be good. So two-thirds of our school districts are below 180 days. 80% of teachers have been furloughed. Thousands of teachers. Over 8,000 teachers have been laid off across the state while student enrollment has increased. So that means significantly larger class sizes for our students. I visited schools in South Georgia, in rural Georgia, back before the holidays. And no textbooks. They haven't bought textbooks in years. The ones that they did have, I saw literally were duct taped together and were 20 years old. The money that the state is sending schools for textbooks, because we have not updated our funding formula since 1985, the money that we're sending them for textbooks is still based on 1985 prices of textbooks. So they can't, even if we were fully funding them, they don't come close to covering the cost of textbooks today. The state of Georgia is funding, spending over $2,000 less per student than the national average in public education. So in visiting some of these schools, I went to an elementary school that the impact of the budget cuts was so severe, they had the lights turned off during the day because they can't afford their power bill. And they just use natural light the best they can. So education is a significant issue for me, because education, in my mind, when you look at economic development, comes back to education. You look at jobs, it comes back to education. You look at poverty, it comes back to education. I personally know the power of education and level playing field. I grew up poor. I'm sure many of you did. I went to college on scholarship, but I knew that I wanted better. And I knew the way to do that was with education. So I know education breaks cycles of poverty. So economic health, you know, we're facing, we've added jobs, absolutely. I will credit the governor with that. But what kinds of jobs have we added? They're not as high paying jobs as the one we've lost. When you look at our national ranking in per capita income, it's fallen every year. In 2001, we ranked 25th in the nation per capita income. 2012, we were 40th. No other state in the Southeast in that time frame fell more than 7 rankings. Georgia fell 15. In fact, there were 2, Tennessee and Alabama, who actually jumped in rankings. Alabama is close to passing Georgia in per capita income in the national ranking. Poverty, we have the 5th highest poverty rate in the nation. 1.7 million children in our public school system, 60% of them eat free and reduced lunch. We have an issue with poverty. We have an issue with per capita income. Yes, we need jobs, but we need some better jobs. We need higher paying jobs. We need tax reform. When you can keep more money in your pocket, that's good for you. It's good for the economy. We need full-scale, comprehensive tax reform in the state, not just playing with things. Okay? We have to look at how we attract business. We give a lot of money away in tax incentives. Over $3 billion in 2014, projected. $3 billion. That's a lot of money. That's more than the $1 billion that we withheld from public education. So there are things that we can look at, that we can do better, that we can balance. We can, if you could, one of the things that we're doing in education to address economic development, if we're working with business and industry, we're bringing business and industry to the table with our educational experts. We've worked with places like Shaw Industries in Dalton. We're working with places like Siemens in Forsyth County. We're working with Georgia Power. All three of those organizations have come to the table and helped us develop courses for high school students in mechatronics, let's say for Shaw Industries, and for Siemens, another kind of advanced manufacturing, and energy courses to develop for our high school students to get them on the path to the types of jobs that are available for them that are high-paying jobs in manufacturing, in energy development, energy creation, energy renewal. And we've also worked with specifically the Savannah-Chatham School District and the Savannah Harbor, and developed a series of courses in maritime logistics so that we can grow a workforce for the Savannah Harbor. So when you can leverage an educational system as a recruiting tool for business and industry and be able to say to them, we can provide you not only with an educated workforce, but a skilled workforce. We can provide you a work-ready job force. That's good economic development. You can attract business and industry with that and with a fully funded educational system. And I don't know that I need to go into a whole lot of the ethics issues. I think y'all probably know most of those. But let me just say this. I think while there are numerous issues in the race for governor that we've talked about, some of them, including ethics, I think they can all be summed up under the umbrella of leadership. And we need some true leadership. And when you look at leadership, true leadership is motivating. It is inspiring. It is not self-motivating or self-promoting. Dwight Eisenhower, arguably one of the most well-liked presidents in our modern history, said that the supreme quality of leadership is integrity. And it just takes a quick review of headlines to see that we don't have a lot of integrity. In fact, the Center for Public Integrity ranks Georgia dead last in the nation in public integrity. I don't know if any of y'all saw it yesterday, but there was a new Gallup poll released yesterday. And they surveyed residents in every state in the country and asked them, you know, if money wasn't an issue, where would you want to live? Where would you want to be? Georgia was a handful of states and the only one in the Southeast, besides Mississippi, where there was an above average desire of the people who lived there to get out. Why is that? We're talking about those reasons. Headlines like ethics report of false ex-congressman, ethics investigation against Georgia governor reportedly turns into criminal probe, loophole surfaces in ethics reform, ethics cases go untouched, public eyes kept off projects. All of these are reasons why Georgia ranks dead last in the nation in public integrity. I think one thing that we need to keep in mind as Republicans, when you look back at the last presidential election, President Obama did not campaign here. He got 47% of the vote. Something I think that we need to look very seriously at is there is a current open investigation of the FBI into our current leadership. There's quite a good possibility that that will become public knowledge or be acted on after the primary. And we have a very good chance of losing the governor's office because there's a lot of ethics and a lot of things that can be campaigned against. So for me personally, it's my family's been here since the late 1700s. My daughter's eighth generation Georgia. And I love this state. I don't want to be anywhere else. But we have some challenges that we need to address, and I think it's time that we have leadership that leads from integrity and a desire to serve. Thank you very much. I will be scooting out pretty soon. I think I've got time for a few questions, and I'll be glad to answer those. And we've got some signs and some brochures to take. Henry, how are you?
I'm fine. I have in my hand a study of the math standards, and I gave you one copy of these about a year ago. And I'm concerned that the way we do addition and subtraction, the standard way, has been moved back to fourth grade. In GPS, it used to be in second grade. And the way we do multiplication has been moved back to fifth grade, the standard way. And percentages are just taken out of elementary school. So now that it's been a year since you've had this study, why was nothing done to address these lower level math standards that were required? And as a former Fayette County School Board member, I could not do anything to stop that.
Well, yes, I do have that study, and that's a study that you performed on the standards. I will tell you that the National Council of Teachers of Mathematics support our current standards, and there are numerous supporters across the state of the current standards. I'm not a math teacher. I was an English teacher. So I have math experts that work on our curriculum. We have over 11,000 teachers from across the state that have been surveyed. 75% of those teachers say these are the right standards. They need some refinement. They're not perfect. And we are in the process of refining them. We are in the process of making revisions to the math standards. But it's going to be based on the feedback from teachers across the state, not just a study done by one person. So we are in the process of doing that. The state board has been challenged by the governor to review the standards, which they are doing. We can't move forward until they have finished their process.
And as a presenter at the NCTM math conferences for years now, they did not ask the membership what they thought about the standards. So that was something that was more of a business decision from the National Council and not based on what the actual math educators thought.
Thank you. Yes?
What role do you think the state government slash the governor to play in the metropolitan area as far as traffic relief? You know, the last T-SPLOS started out as traffic relief, or at least that was what they were advertised, and turned into economic development. You think the state should have a role in the metropolitan area and or the traffic?
Well, absolutely. I think we should be partners with you and help you with the issues that you have. So I think that they should. Again, I don't think that the state should be overly prescriptive, because there are, you know, education, for example, is a local control issue. We don't mandate a lot of things to your county school district, because you guys, you have elected officials that have been elected in charge with that. So absolutely, we can be partners with you, but I don't think we need to be overly prescriptive. Yes.
Conservative critics of Common Core consider Common Core to be a Trojan horse for the far left, for a progressive agenda, for an anti-American agenda, an anti-constitutional agenda, an anti-freedom agenda. All of the things that we value in this room, such as the American flag, the state flag, our Bill of Rights, all of that is being shredded inside of Common Core, these conservative critics have included. How do you answer that charge?
Well, I don't agree with it. I have always been a conservative my entire life, but also as a professional educator and an expert in education, someone who's working with Washington. The standards were not developed by Washington. The state was not forced to adopt them. Our state board voluntarily adopted those. It was prior to my election, but they voluntarily adopted them. And we have complete authority still as a state to determine our own standards. In fact, as I was saying to Mary Kay, we are in the process of making those revisions now to the standards to improve them and to make them the best standards for our students. There are no Common Core standards for social studies. There are no Common Core standards for science. There are some science standards that have been developed at the national level, but we have not evaluated them and have no intention of adopting them, as far as I know. It's not, you know, I'm not making that recommendation to the board. We reviewed those standards, and our folks determined they were pretty weak. So We will be revising our own science standards here in the near future, but we will not be using the national standards that have been created. So the state is not required to adopt them. We're not forced to use them. And there are great standards. I will tell you one standard. The standards are in English and math. As an 11th grade, well, I taught high school English. One of the 11th grade English standards specifically reads that students should be able to read and analyze 17th and 18th century U.S. foundational documents, including the Constitution, the Preamble, the Bill of Rights, the Lincoln's Second Inaugural Address, and several others that are named, for their rhetorical language and literary features. If we don't teach that, what do we teach? So it's not, a lot of people are confusing curriculum and instructional resources with the standard. The standards are broad overarching principles that states have agreed for the sake of mobility from state to state that kids need to know and be able to do so they don't fall through the cracks when they move. But Georgia education is a local control issue. So what curriculum and what resources that Cobb County uses to get to that standard is still up to Cobb County. And most of people's concern has been over what is being used to teach the standard with, like worksheets, things that have or suggested readings that are very liberal books. And the national organization, the national group that put together National Governors Association, NCCSSO, that put the standards together, did produce a what's called Appendix B of the standards, which is recommended readings and performance tasks, suggested exemplars, that type of thing. We did not adopt that. We don't have it on our website. We don't recommend it to our folks to use. As a state, we actually produced all of our own resources. We have them available for districts to use if they want to, but we don't mandate because folks in Cobb County know best what to use. All right? Yes, ma'am.
Mentioning what the teachers and the students are having to go through with the textbooks falling apart and the lights turned off in the daytime, most of us in this room have heard for years and years and years of putting more money into education, more money into education. That's the big thing every time in the election. However, a lot of us have learned that much of that money goes to administration or the NEA for their lobbying effects in Washington, the lobby against the parents and local control. So what if you as governor, I know there's certain things you can and cannot do, but a lot of us are tired of hearing about what our students are having to give up, and the administration and the NEA are just hoarding it for other purposes.
Well, let me answer that strictly from the state perspective, because a lot of money that is put into education here locally is coming from your local tax dollars. Okay? For example, there was an article on the front page of the Atlanta Journal a couple weeks ago that listed the salaries of superintendents in some of the metro area school districts. Very lucrative salaries for some of them. Okay? The state pays the same dollar amount to every school district in the state for superintendent. And I believe it's something like $52,000 or something like that. If they're a certified teacher, they have a base state salary pay that just like every other teacher receives. All the rest of that money is negotiated locally with the local school system. Where that becomes an issue is outside of the metro area, where there is no tax base in these rural communities to support or prop up the lack of funding from the state. That's why you have the lights turned off and no tax base in these rural communities. Because in some of these communities, you can raise their taxes, you can raise their millage rate a full mill, and one mill of tax is only going to raise $60,000 in a year. So you can't raise taxes enough locally in some of our rural communities to make up the difference. So most of, and the NEA, there is no money from the state that goes to the NEA. We don't fund any organizations. We don't fund any of those. There's nothing state money goes to that. That's all individual teachers who pay their own dues to belong to those organizations. So the state doesn't fund those at all. Over 80% of the money that comes from the state goes directly to local school districts to pay teacher salaries. All right, thank you very much.
Okay, Art, hold up. Art Gardner is running for U.S. Senate.
I can't tell you how excited I am to be here this morning. I've been in Cobb County for 30 years. This is my home county, and it is a tremendous honor and privilege to address you this morning. I've been speaking all over this state, from one corner of the state to the other, as a Senate candidate, and this is my Super Bowl to be here with you this morning. I'm really excited. I'm very proud to be in Georgia, and I think we live in the greatest state in the Union, and I think Cobb County is the best state in Georgia. We have the best government, the best political leaders, the most efficient services. I love Cobb County and wouldn't live anywhere else. Now I'm going to talk to you about three things today. One is, how do we fix our budget problem? How do we fix the national budget problem? Secondly, what is the appropriate direction for the Republican Party in order to grow and win a lot of elections and stop the left's agenda? And third, what are we going to do about health care? What are we going to do about health care? Now, my name is Art Gardner. I'm 55 years old. I've been married for 32 years. My wife and I have three adult children. Our kids went to Wheeler High School and all the public schools here in the county. I was a 14-year-old Eagle Scout candidate when I gave up scouting to start working full-time in my father's business. Worked full-time as a mechanic, car mechanic, all through high school, even during the school year. My dad didn't want me to go to college. He thought it was a waste of time, but I insisted on going to college. I didn't listen to my dad like a lot of kids don't. And went to Georgia Tech, worked my way through Georgia Tech, paid my own way through Tech. Got a degree in mechanical engineering, went to work at the bomb plant making C-5s at the bomber plant. So I worked for Lockheed for 5 years as a manufacturing engineer. While working for Lockheed, I went to law school at night and became a patent attorney 26 years ago. Worked mostly in small law firms during that time, and 18 years ago started my own firm. We have a handful of lawyers and 18 employees. We mostly help folks who come up with an invention, we help them get a patent, that's our business. So over the last 41 years I've worked as a problem solver all that time, and mostly in small businesses. I appreciate the job creation role that small businesses play in our economy. And I really am a problem solver. I approach policy issues from the standpoint of how do we make things better? How do we address this? So I'm more focused on policy than politics. And I like to say that if I can't fix it, it probably ain't broke. Now, let's talk about the budget. I think everybody understands that this is a spending problem, not a taxation problem. We are spending too much, not taxing too little. And if you look at spending patterns and taxation patterns over the last 70 years, you'll see that we have never collected more than 21% of GDP as our tax collections, no matter what the rates have been. Rates were as high as 90% at the top, 70%, 50%. Rates have been all over the map, but we've never collected more than 21%. Of GDP. That ought to be the limit of our spending, or something even less than it. Our actual average is 19%. So we ought to find a way to live within that. The problem is that some of our spending categories are on an upwardly increasing trend line that will bankrupt us. It is not defense. Defense is one-fifth of our budget. Defense is trending down over the last 70 years. Defense spending is not going crazy. It's not discretionary spending. Things like the roads and the EPA and the FBI, things like that. That also is not trending up. Social Security is not the big bugaboo either. Social Security, although it's currently at 5% of GDP, Social Security is on a trend line to grow to 6 and then come back down to 5 over time. So we're not going to go broke because of Social Security. Welfare is not the problem either. Welfare has been steadily growing since the 30s. but it's not on a path that's going to wreck us. Doggone water. It's healthcare. Healthcare is on a trend line that is going to wreck the system. And overall, government spending is trending up, strongly up, in large measure because of healthcare. We can't spend 25% of GDP from the government and take in 20% year after year. That creates this mountainous debt that we have, and that's going to be ruinous to the country one day. And how will that happen? That'll happen because one day, some country, it won't be us first, but some country, will default on their debt. And when they do, investors worldwide will say, gee, I don't think government bonds are as safe as I thought they were. I'm not going to invest my money in the United States for a 2% return. I want 8%. Well, when that happens, the interest payments on our mountainous debt are going to start to rise. Eventually, the interest payments alone on the debt will consume a significant fraction of the government's income, the amount of money that the government can take in. There won't be anything left over to pay for social services, to pay for the military, and things like that. It will spiral out of control very quickly. So it is essential that we Americans figure out a way to live within our means, period. And to do that, I think the Republican Party has got to win a lot of elections. I am serious about this budget thing. This is what got me in the race. I'm not a career politician. You know, I've spent my life as a mechanic, as an engineer, now as a patent lawyer. I've never been involved in politics. But when I saw that this is the path we're on, and the politicians are more interested in getting elected than getting the problem solved, I decided to get involved myself. So that's what I've been doing for the last 2 years. And I'm dead serious about solving the problem. I've put on my website at gardnersenate.com specific budget cuts that need to be made to bring down the deficit, balance our budget, get us back on the right path. Do not trust a politician if they stand up and say, I'm for balancing the budget, but they won't tell you how they're going to do it. They're just fibbing to you. They want to get elected. They're not serious about balancing the budget. That's standard campaign rhetoric. Now, just this week, Alan Buckley, a longtime budget hawk and two-time Senate candidate in the Libertarian Party, gave me his public endorsement, which is quite unusual for a candidate from one party to endorse another candidate in a different party. But Alan believes, like I do, that we have serious budget problems that call for real cuts, not political slogans. We need to make real cuts. So, if you'll help me, we can fix this budget problem. Now, in order to fix the budget problem, we've got to win elections, which is the second thing I want to talk about. To win elections, we need to broaden our base. Too much lately, our party is becoming narrower and narrower. We need to attract, again, because we used to do a better job of this, we need to attract more women, we need to attract more minorities, we need to attract gays, and we especially, most importantly, we need to attract young people to the party. And what is the problem? The problem is that we are pushing the social issues too much. Too much. We should be focused on real governance, which is getting our financial house in order, maintaining a strong defense. When we push social conservative issues as government policy, we are driving away large blocks of voters. Sure, it's great for the social conservatives in our party, and lots of people are that way. And I'm not arguing that social conservatives are wrong to think what they think. Because most social conservatives, the vast majority of social conservatives, have reached those positions after lots of thought, prayer. Those are deep-seated beliefs, and it's not for me to say, I mean this in all sincerity, it is not for me to say they are wrong to have those beliefs. With all due respect, it's just not my place. But we need to build a coalition around the things that we can agree on, which are the fiscal matters and defense, and agree to disagree on the social issues. If we can do that, we can build this party into a Big Ten party, win a lot of elections, and then we can stop the destruction of America. And make no mistake, if we don't solve this budget problem, we are in serious trouble. What is going to happen? Think about it. What is going to happen if the government can't send out those checks every month? We have tens of millions of people who are dependent on the government for their health care or for their income, some form of assistance. What's going to happen to our society if the government can't pay that? We're going to have anarchy. Well, what's wrong with anarchy, some people might say? Well, we have a country with 300 million guns. Think of what that anarchy is going to look like if people are trying to struggle to survive because the government can't do what the government has promised. It's a frightening prospect. We really need to fix this problem. And it's not right to just push this big debt off on our children and our grandchildren and say, oh, well, I spent this money, you know, I enjoyed these services, now you get stuck with a $75,000 national debt. I won't be around anymore, it's your problem, deal with it, son. We need to do better than that. Now, the third thing I want to talk to you about is healthcare. Healthcare, there's lots of problems with healthcare. One of which is Obamacare. Obamacare is, in my view, an abomination. The law was passed as a pure partisan act. And anybody who's opposed to that law is entirely within their rights to say, that's not my law, that was your law. Don't give me this nonsense about it's the law of the land. It was the law of the Democrats, period. So don't give me this stuff about it's the law of the land. That's why they rushed it through. They had that brief window of time when they had the White House, the Senate, and the House. And they said, oh, we can't debate on this bill because we're about to lose the House. So let's rush this thing through before anybody has a chance to even read it. Well, that's not the law of the land. That's a partisan bill. We've never done that before. The New Deal, the Voting Rights Act, the Civil Rights Act, the Environmental Protection Act, all of those sea change legislative acts in the government were passed on a bipartisan basis. Do you know, for example, that the Republican Party had a higher percentage of support for the Voting Rights Act and the Civil Rights Act than the Democrat Party did? That's how we go forward as a nation. We do big things in a bipartisan manner, together. Not one party or the other. It's just wrong. And so, anybody that's opposed to Obamacare, I'm good with that. No problem. Because I'm opposed to Obamacare. But healthcare, let's talk about healthcare. You know, Obamacare is largely an enormous omnibus bill to deal with insurance, how it's paid for, who pays for it. Not so much with how much it costs. And one of the big problems that we have in this country is that healthcare is very expensive. We pay more for healthcare than anybody else in the world. One of the reasons for that is that we pay more for medicine, the pills that we take. We pay a lot more for medicine than anybody else. And you've all probably been aware that people will get in a bus and drive across the Canadian border to buy medicine in Canada, go shopping for pills in Canada or in Mexico. Why is that? Why is medicine a lot more expensive in the United States than in Canada? The reason is that when you come up with a new medicine, you go to the government and you get a patent for it. That's something I know about, a patent lawyer. The government gives you, in exchange for your new development, they give you this patent, which is a monopoly. You have a monopoly power. This is not a free market situation. You have complete control of this market. You can charge whatever you want. That's the idea behind a monopoly. And we still provide the drug companies that true monopoly market power. But our competitors in the G7 do not. The other countries in the G7 have stripped the drug companies of their monopoly power, either by strict price controls, like in Canada, they have a pricing board, and the drug companies have to go through this board and get their prices approved, or by having a single payer system or a single purchaser system. The net effect is the other countries in the G7 are paying a lot less than the drug companies need in order to make a reasonable profit. And make no mistake, developing new drugs is incredibly expensive. It takes a long time. The drug companies need a substantial profit in order for that to work out. I'm not up here saying that the drug companies don't deserve to make a big profit. That is not the point. But what's going on in America right now is we are subsidizing the cost of drugs in Germany. We're subsidizing the cost of drugs in Sweden. We're subsidizing the cost of drugs in Japan. We're paying a lot more so that they can pay a lot less. To give you an example, I take Crestor, which is a statin. It's a pill that you take every day. In the United States, that has a list price of $7.50. I think if you do the math, it's about $2,700 a year for this little pill. If you have insurance, your insurance company will get it at a slight discount, about a 10% discount. It'll be a little under $7, $6.75, $6.50, something like that. And you'll be paying, or your insurance company will be paying about $2,400 a year for this medicine. In Canada, it's $1.78. It's the same medicine. It's about $700 a year. We're paying a couple $1,000s extra for just that one medicine. Well, no wonder healthcare is a lot more expensive here. So I have proposed a change in the patent laws. And this is a game changer. And this is not something that's out there in the literature. This is something that I came up with after a lot of thought, that I have proposed a change in the patent law to make it patent misuse for the drug companies to gouge Americans so that they can subsidize the cost overseas. If they're going to charge us more than 25% more than they're going to charge the other G7 countries, their patent would be at risk of being declared invalid for misuse. And when they get to 50%, it's actually good. Thank you. Now, I think we can all understand that we should pay more than the undeveloped world. You know, we should pay more for drugs than folks in Africa who are living on $1 a day. But it makes no sense for us to be paying a lot more than other countries in the G7. Now, the AJC has labeled my proposal as the most innovative thing they've seen in healthcare yet. And they're going to be doing a feature story on this tomorrow. So look for that in your paper. So this is an idea that I hope will get legs, and regardless of how my race goes, this idea needs to be pushed on a national stage. This needs to become the law of the land, period. This will be very impactful. You know, as people like to say, you know, it's one thing to talk about the weather, but nobody ever does anything about it. Well, healthcare is like that. I'm doing something about it. This will change the cost of medicine and healthcare in America. And with your help, we can get that done. Now, last thing I want to leave you with is, you know, if something unforeseen happens and I don't end up in the runoff, I'm going to support our nominee. It is essential that our party rally behind the nominee, that we win this seat. We, the Republicans, need to win elections. We need to win this seat. We cannot allow the Democrats to steal this seat and send what is essentially a sheep in wolf's clothing to Washington. So with your help, I'm going to win this nomination. I'm going to win this seat. But if not, join me in supporting our nominee And let's win this seat and keep it in Republican hands. Thank you.
For example, why couldn't we go from Monday, Wednesday, and Friday in this section of town, and Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday in that section of town, and theoretically cut the post office 50%? In the meantime, reallocate all of our resources so we can be competitive with UPS and FedEx instead of sitting around behind the counter not serving anybody. I got first-hand experience in San Francisco, in Dallas, in Wiggum, Georgia, Chattanooga, Tennessee, Tallahassee, Florida. I know what I'm talking about.
Well, I come to this question sort of as well.
I don't want to get you off your stride. I like what you say.
I don't have all the answers for how to solve the problems at the post office. I can't say that my late mother would have worked in the post office, and she was a brilliant woman and refused being elevated to the local postmaster because her thinking was, if I can't fire anybody, then I don't want to be in charge.
with the government committee. And anybody that would like to help, I'd like to get at it.
Honestly, I don't have a good answer to your question.
But maybe they do.
Yes, but one question.
Hi, good morning, everybody. My name is Sarah Morgan. I'm Barry Morgan's wife. I have to say that I fundamentally disagree with your so-called innovative program with healthcare. It takes over $100 billion to produce one pharmaceutical that comes to FDA approval. And you're talking about profit. If you're referring to the minute that drug is FDA approved, that corporation has to pay back that $100 million that they've invested to bring that one drug to market. So by saying that you are going to limit that, 80% of all drug trials that are FDA approved occur here in the United States. And without that FDA approval, we will not know if those drugs are safe without those clinical trials for humans to take those drugs. So yes, other companies do benefit through our process, but those corporations have to recoup that $100 billion. And to bring a drug up to human trials is $50 billion. So with $50 billion for a drug that never makes it, how do you propose those companies make up for those losses?
Well, the answer is that I'm not opposed to drug companies making a huge profit. I'm not. Not at all. What I'm saying is what they're doing, because the foreign countries are keeping them from making any profit in those other countries, they are forced to charge us an exorbitant price. And that's not right. We can't stand for that anymore. It's not right that they should make all of their profit here and none of it in Europe, for example. That's just not right. And what my proposal will do is not only will it lower the cost of medicine here in the U.S., it will force the drug companies to go to those other countries and say, look, we can't gouge the Americans anymore. We're going to have to raise the price of this medicine in Japan. We're going to have to raise the price of this medicine in Germany because we can't unfairly take advantage of the Americans anymore. Prices of medicine around the world will go up. The price of medicine in the United States will go down. That's what will happen over time. But yes, I agree with you that the drug companies need to make a big profit. That's inherent. It's a high risk, high cost business. Absolutely. Thank you for your question.
Very special place to meet my wife. She's from Cobb County. Both my children were born at Kennesaw Hospital. We lived here 6 years out of college. Both my in-laws still live here across from Marietta High School, so Cobb County has been very good to me. But I'm David Pennington. I'm running for governor. I'm a private business person, not a professional politician, but I'm running to restore Georgia back to our rightful place, which is the most powerful, successful economy in the South. And I know how to do that. You do that by adhering to limited government principles of less spending, less taxes, less regulations, and opening transparent government. It's not campaign promises to me. I've done it. As Mayor of Dalton, we cut property taxes 6 straight years by a total of almost 30%. We haven't had a countywide loss in 6 years. We've had the lowest sales tax in Georgia. We cut most business license fees from 25 to 50%. Cut the downtown development authority tax by two-thirds. We're one of the first communities in America to take out traffic cameras because they're just an unnecessary revenue grab. And I want people to understand that I wasn't doing this to serve myself. I contributed to my mayor's salary at Dalton State College every year to provide dozens of scholarships for kids at Dalton State College. Now, how's that worked out for Dalton? 2012, Dalton ranked 9th amongst all American cities in fastest growing incomes because limited government principles work. While we're doing that in Dalton, I watched the state of Georgia, under the leadership of Nathan Deal, do just the opposite. Increase spending by $3.5 billion in less than 4 years. Raise taxes multiple ways, whether it be internet taxes, nursing home taxes, but I'm going to concentrate on one tax, the new way we tax automobiles in this state, the TEBT tax. Now, this is a state that we're already the most expensive state in America to own and operate a vehicle in. The most expensive state in America to own or operate a vehicle in. Not California, not New Jersey, not New York, but Georgia. More than twice the surrounding states. So we decided to come up with a new scheme to tax automobiles, which has now turned into one of the largest tax increases in Georgia history. First 8 months of this fiscal year's in, it's bringing in almost $35 million a month in new tax revenue. Now, they also claim that they did away with the birthday tax. Well, first of all, if you haven't bought a new car, you're still driving an older car, you're still paying your birthday tax. But worse than that, birthday tax wasn't the state revenue source. It was a local revenue source. Very easy for me to cut the taxes in Tennessee or Mississippi. And as that birthday tax does roll off, local school boards, city councils, county commissions, don't raise your property taxes, while the state's made off to throw us the revenue in its spending. Third, you can't operate a democracy unless you're open and transparent. And this state is as far from being open and transparent as any state you'll find in America. And I'll talk about another tax, the hospital bed tax. It was passed 4 years ago, behest of Sonny Perdue, as a temporary measure to fund Medicare. I didn't like the way they did it then because it puts too much burden on small businesses. But at least they made the legislature vote on that tax, because our Georgia Constitution says only the legislature has the power to levy taxes. Nathan Deal came up with a better scheme for that, where so-called limited government conservatives wouldn't have to vote on tax increase. And I know most of them are limited government conservatives because they come in front of us, campaign as that, and then they do just the opposite when they go to the state legislature. They moved that tax to an unelected board, Department of Community Health, and let them levy the tax, which they immediately did at 1.45% of hospital revenues. It brings in about $240 million a year. But the worst thing is, that unelected board has the power to take that to 6%, which will be a $1 billion tax increase, and you will never see your legislature vote on it. And they're going to do it. Yeah. How do I know they're going to do it? Because Nathan Deal said the precedent for that tax was the nursing home bed tax. They did the same thing in 2003, moving from the legislature to an unelected board, appointed by the governor, Department of Community Health. They levied that tax in 2003, $7.35 per bed per day. And then 2 years later, it's at its maximum, of $17.10 per bed per day, increased 28% while Nathan Deal's been governor. The same thing is going to happen with that hospital bed tax. And how's this worked out for Georgia? We have the third highest teenage unemployment rate in America. We have the fourth highest long-term unemployment rate in America, more than twice the surrounding states. We have the fifth highest poverty rate in America. And what makes that poverty rate so bad is that the four states below us are very small states. Mississippi with 2.9 million people, New Mexico with 1.9 million people. Georgia has over 10 million people, and when you have that high of a poverty rate, it's disaster brewing. It's consuming the entire state budget. Most of the jobs we've created over the last 4 years have been minimum wage and part-time jobs with no health care benefits. And Superintendent Barge alluded to, a study that just released yesterday, almost 40% of Georgians want to move out of the state of Georgia. Once again, much higher than the surrounding states. That's our present. That doesn't have to be our future. Georgia has wonderful economic assets. That's why we led the nation in per capita income growth from 1970s to 1990s. We trailed the saints. We've got to get back to what made Georgia great, which is limited government principles. The income tax immediately from 6% to 4% because we have the ninth highest in America and the highest in the Southeast. We need to do it for three reasons. Number one, small businesses generate 65% of the net new jobs in America. I'm a small business person. Many of you are. We pay our corporate taxes through our personal tax returns. Small businesses are dead in the water in Georgia. Secondly, for people that work for large corporations. GE Power Systems used to be headquartered in Atlanta with no other headquarters. They're now spreading that out to Texas and one other state. And why are they doing it? Because the taxes are too high in Georgia. There's no state income tax in Texas. Oh. It will immediately put $2.7 billion a year in private people's hands to spend in Georgia businesses and invest in new opportunities. Second thing we need to do on taxes, we need to allow 100% expensing of all capital purchases in the first year by all Georgia businesses. Because that will provide the best job with health care benefits and help on Medicaid also. The reason I know that, I was the mayor of the carpet capital of the world, Dolphin, Georgia, which is the last manufacturing center left in Georgia. Georgia should be a manufacturing powerhouse. We have all the assets to do that if we use the right tax and regulatory policies. We have the best ports in America. Best airport in the world, best interstate system in the South, best railroad network in the South, great universities, competitive utilities. There is no excuse for Georgia to lose more manufacturing jobs per capita than any other state in the South over the last decade, except our policies and taxes are just wrong. You can't have a 21st century economy if you don't have a 21st century education system. You can trace the decline in public education in this state, in this country. First, the centralization of all the power and authority in state capitals, and now in Washington, D.C. 1900, only 10% of 18-year-olds had a high school diploma in this country. By 1970, 80% had a high school diploma in this country. Those 70 years was almost complete local control. I'm not just against Washington control, I'm against Atlanta control. We need to decentralize. Power authority back to local school teachers and local school boards to do what they've been so well trained to do. I can tell you, from Dalton, Georgia and Whitfield County, we're far better off that way. We're already funding half of it anyway. That's why I'm completely opposed to Common Core. Centralized power and authority doesn't work. That's why the Soviet Union fell apart. Why are we going down the same road? Lastly, on education, obviously we need a lot more kids in Georgia, as Nathan Deal said, going to college and technical schools. For the last 2 years, Nathan Deal's been governor. For the first time since the early 1970s, we've lost kids in the university system. His plan didn't seem to be working very well. Why didn't it work? Because from 2007 through 2012, the net cost to college and technical school tuition in Georgia grew by an astounding 77%. This is after all hope grants and all other scholarships. Next closest state to us, once again, we led the nation in that. It was New Mexico at 54%. California didn't grow at all. Our tuition cost is out of control. This year, they're increasing again at Georgia Tech, University of Georgia, by 79%. We have got to get control of that spending, or else we're going to make sure, and we probably already have, we're going to price an education, college education, out of most typical Georgia's hands to be able to pay for it. This state's going to require bold changes to turn it around, because economic momentum works for you or against you. Many years in Georgia, from the 70s through the 90s, it worked for us. And we could go past a lot of speed bumps. Now it's working against us. And to turn that around is going to require bold changes. You're not going to allow politicians you don't trust to make those bold changes. And it's once again Superintendent Barge alluded to. We rank fifth in integrity, fifth in corruption. First thing we need to do is what the state legislature and the governor's office decided a long time ago. They decided city councils, county commissions, local school boards had to be under open meeting laws. And I support open meeting laws. But they exempted themselves from them. They need to be under the same open meeting laws. Yeah. It's amazing how much better government gets when you let the sun shine in.
Yes. Yes.
The last part, obviously, I think we've probably read a little bit down here about our ethics commission debacle. How can you have an ethics commission appointed by the very, very people that they have to investigate? We need a constitutional amendment that allows the judiciary to appoint the ethics commission, set a $7 million floor for their funding to allow them to do their job. We've got to restore the trust in order to make the change that we need. Georgia Republicans have been in charge of the governor's office, or so-called Republicans. We've got to remember they were Democrats. Since 2002. The legislature's been under Republican control since 2004. And explain to me how we go that long. No tax reform, no tort reform, no malpractice reform, no regulatory reform, no nothing. And how's that worked out? But at the turn of the century, Georgia's about to crack the top 20 in every economic indicator. We were the marvel of the South. Since then, we're now in the bottom 10, not the bottom 5. And one thing about Cobb County, to me too, besides being very special because of my family, y'all have always been the bell cow. Conservative movement of Georgia. Where Cobb County goes, the state goes. Either way. And hopefully Cobb County will heed this wake-up call. Because this is the wake-up call for the Georgia Republican Party. They got it from a party line vote that Georgia graduates voted for. They wanted a medical school, Same thing. Augusta Medical does a pretty good job with it already. University of Georgia, it has the lowest space utilization rate of all universities at 31%. It's still building. It's out of control. But believe me, you appoint people to that board to do their job, and hopefully, if you're a limited government conservative, you're going to find other limited government conservatives to operate on that board. That's what needs to happen. Yes, sir.
Problem we had talking about financing, talking about education and things. The biggest problem, it seems to me, that we have here is the rise of the nanny state. And by that, I mean not just in the state of Georgia, not just in the country, but all around. A lot of parents are under the mistaken idea that they think that they're put on this earth to protect their children. Nothing can be further than the truth. They're put on this earth to teach their children. The world, we live in a nasty world. And to teach their children how to cope in that world. The same thing goes for government. Government is not put here to protect us. Every time somebody tells me they're protecting my bill folk, I automatically distrust that person. Got here, we don't seem to have in the Republican Party the ability to put that into the right words where people can understand. Our message is mixed up, it's convoluted. We've got a bunch of people jumping up and saying, hey, look at me. I've got an answer. Until we solve that problem of a government, whether it be local, state, or national, until we solve that problem of them running our life from birth to the grave,
right,
we're going to have that problem. And the Republican Party gets to where they can put that message out there in a manner that will get people's attention. We're going to lose.
Well, first of all, we need to break problem. We need to elect Republicans to believe what you just said. Most don't. The number one problem this country's got at the moment is this. In this century, I'm not talking about the 20th century that was 100 years long. I'm talking about the 21st century that's 13 years long. We've gone from first to 11th in worldwide freedom rights. We're now below Canada. Our birthright as Americans was to live in the freest nation on earth.
Yes,
it was. Now, yes. 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 16th in economic freedoms. And if you fall below the 80th percentile, you're no longer considered a free economy, you're considered a mostly free economy. We fell to the 79th percentile last year. Every politician, you don't remember anything else I said today, every politician that comes before, I don't care if it's Congress, Senate, state legislature, governor, county commission, school board member, or city council member, ask them one question. What are you going to do to give me back my birthright, which is to live in the freest nation on earth? Thank you.
Yes.
Okay. Tell you what, everybody who is running for office this time around, or if you're representing someone who is running for office, will you please stand up where you are right now? Everybody stand up that's running for office. Okay, we're going to do this the same way we did last time here because we're very short of time. Y'all sit back down. We'll start right here at this table. If you haven't already spoken, then stand up, give us your name and office, your running card. But no speeches, please, okay? All right, start at this table.
Barry Loudermilk, running for the 11th Congressional District, standwithbarry.com. May 13th, Eric Erickson hosting fundraiser for us, Landmark Real and Buckhead. Hope to see you. All right.
Wade, candidate for Superior Court Judge, votemakerwade.com.
Anybody standing back over here? No, wait a minute. If you're sitting at a table, anybody standing? Starting up here.
Cool. Yeah, Zach Lindsay. My dad's Ed Lindsay. He's running for the 11th District.
Thank you. Ready?
Austin Chambers with David Perdue's campaign is running for U.S. Senate.
Anybody else up, Bill?
Bill Byrne, District 1 Commission seat.
Ann Harris, Senior Assistant District Attorney, candidate for Superior Court Judge. Superior Court Judge.
Charles Gregory, House District 34, Kennesaw, Marietta.
Anyone else standing? Okay.
Barry Morgan, Solicitor General, running for re-election. Thank you so much.
I'm Mac Burgess. I'm here on behalf of Trisha Podmore. She was here a few minutes ago. She took off. We're knocking doors today like we do every weekend. We've hit 17,000 so far in the last couple of months. We're going to hit a couple more thousand today. So Podmore for Congress, 11th District. So,
okay.
I'm Mary Kay Buffayam. I'm running for State School Superintendent for Academic Freedom and to Stop the Common Core.
Right. I'm Mike Wilkins, running for Cobb Commissioner, District 3. Website, Wilkins, numeric 4, Cobb.com.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Joanne Burrell, your District 3 Cobb County Commissioner. I ask for your prayer, support, and your vote on May 20th to continue my conservative principles and values.
I'm Cheryl Dawes, and I'm running for State School Superintendent. I'm a 6th District resident, and I was born at Travis Air Force Base, a daughter of an Air Force brat.
My name is Donald Fritz. I'm representing Karen Handel tonight. So today, I'd like all of y'all to early vote for her and vote for her on May 20th.
Early enough.
Right here. Okay, that too.
Hi, I'm Kevin Nicholas. I'm running for school board, post 6 in East Cobb, and just been endorsed by Educators First and the MDJ, and most importantly, our neighbors. So thank you for your support on May 20th, post 6, Cobb School Board. Thank you.
Just last week, she was endorsed by law enforcement by Sheriff Neil Warren and former Sheriff Bill Hudson to be your next Cobb County Superior Court Judge, so thank you.
I'm Bill Buckley here on behalf of Congressman Jack Kingston for the U.S. Senate. We'd like your vote on the 20th. Thank you.
John L. Woody for Burt Breach. Burt was recently endorsed by Sheriff Neil Warren, District Attorney Vic Reynolds for House District 34. Appreciate your vote, and you're more than welcome to contact me if you want to volunteer.
Anybody I missed anywhere in the room, raise your hand or put it on your piece. Okay, folks, we've enjoyed having you this morning. I'm sorry. Announcements.
Yes, sir.
Okay, sorry about that, Carolyn.
I can sneak about enough. I'm going to stand right here because I have too many chairs. I'm Carolyn Garcia with Americans for Prosperity, Georgia. There's several of these on your table. We are having a Freedom Phone Marathon this whole month. We're asking if you want to get together or just do it from your own home. We did about 50,000 phone calls 2 weeks ago in an 8-hour period, and they go really quickly. We provide all the materials. You don't even have to pay for any phone calls or anything else. If you want to have a party at your house of 3 or 4 people, we'll even bring you dinner, and we'll spend an hour just doing phone calls. We're going to have prizes for the person that makes the most phone calls in a month. On the back of it, you'll see where we're also taking reservations now for the Defending the American Dream Summit that's going on in Dallas, Texas, the end of August. We have a great event every year in different states, and you can contact us on this flyer to find out more about it. We're going to have scholarships available for people who need help financially, so it'll be a really big help there. And next week, we're supposed to have this past week since voting started, but we're going to have our voter guides, and we're looking for people who would like to help us distribute the voter guides. Contact Joel's number that's on here, and I'll get with you, or Joel will. If you'd like to volunteer to do any of the phone banking, and when I say phone banking, it's just a marathon that goes very quickly in an hour. See me afterwards, and I can set you up with whatever times that you're looking to do it. So thank you, sir.
Thank you. Okay, y'all still want to stay seated just a minute. We're almost finished here. Just a minute.
I'd just like to announce that this video will be available on YouTube. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Robert Potts, State and Freedom Coalition. With respect to all candidates, there is still a good portion of the electorate that believes in our faith-based principles across this country. We have a huge conference coming up this June 19th through the 21st in Washington, D.C. We have bus packages for anyone from Georgia wanting to go, starting at $199, covering your registration, your hotel, and your bus package. We've got every candidate running for president coming to this conference. We all come here on Saturdays, we go to church on Sundays, we hear the rhetoric, but it's time to put it in practice. We have breakout sessions teaching you how to be an effective messenger for your conservative movement and your party. Come see me afterwards, we'd love to have you there. God bless you, thank you all for being here.
So please watch the website. We're gonna have something on there, we're gonna see Bo Bauer and Smith, a story fund. Those are the people that you gave this morning, we took up $300, appreciate it. And I tell you what, today's a race where you can put your money on the nose of a horse. So after today, put your money on the nose of your candidate and get out there and work.